are, of course, carbon from burnt sticks, and then, of course, naturally occurring colored clays. So we have sienna, and then we have carbon, we have burnt sienna. So we have as many different clays as they could lay their hands on. Jumping forward thousands and thousands of years, 20,000 years, getting into our earliest civilizations, we have people like the Sumerians and the Ur standard. This is all lapis lazuli, of course, cut around here. But in cutting and fitting this together, it didn't take long to find out that as you were cutting on a stone with a harder stone, that you were going to get powder. And of course, the powder was going to color your hands. And hey, guess what? If it colors my hands, I can use it to color an object. And of course, the Egyptians, all the tombs are filled with color. The Egyptians were one of the earliest groups to come up with the idea of using frits in glasses and then grinding up the glass, colored glasses, aquamarine or blue-colored glasses or green-colored glasses. Once again, jumping forward another 1,000 years, we come to the Romans. And because many of the houses actually were done with an interior courtyard, that meant the bedrooms and the rooms off the side of the house had no windows. They looked inside the courtyard, but they had no windows to the outside world. So very often, they began painting landscapes on the wall so that as they would lay in bed, they would have a vista looking out. The Roman, they're already developing form through here. And it's using small hatch lines, which is exactly the way they'll be doing 1,000 years later in the medieval period with the Egg Tempera. Jumping forward 1,000 years, and these are egg temperas, and they're using it both in very flat areas, linear, and then attempting to develop form already by using the white as in a cross-hatching method. Once again, drawn, it's really, the forms are really drawn and delineated through drawing. The thing that happens with egg tempera is it doesn't really, the beauty of oil paint, of course, is that you develop forms with the oil. Egg tempera is a much more linear process. It lends itself more to line. Now, of course, what happens is in early Renaissance, things, you know, they really exploit the medium to, you know, as far as they can. They push it and push it and push it, trying to develop forms and three-dimensionality through modeling. And what they, the way they do this, which I'll demonstrate to you, is by slowing the process down to the point where they're using an almost dry brush and just the tiniest bit of pigment and very slowly raking and raking and raking, trying to build form. And of course, oil paint comes in shortly after this, which pretty much kills it because oil paint really allows you to model. It stays wet long enough that you can add forms and develop forms. And of course, at High Renaissance, you have, as I said, a complete development, really pushing it as far as it would go, which of course is why oil comes in. They really pushed egg tempera to its outer limits. Now Leonardo, even though he was using oil, would use what's called a combination or a mixed technique, mixing egg yolk in with his oil paints to do very, very tiny things like this on the hair, just to lay them on the surface. They have a slightly raised quality to it. What happens is that the egg yolk makes the oil set up very quickly, like that. So you can draw, you have to have an underpainting of oil first, and while it's wet, you paint with the egg oil emulsion, it's called, an egg oil emulsion, which you shake up. You paint that right into the wet oil paint, and you can make very crisp details, which just stay there. If they were mixed with oil itself, by the time you diluted it with turpentine to hold its ridge, it wouldn't. It would hold when you drew it, but within a minute or two, it would start spreading out. Okay, this is a contemporary, let's see the plate, so this is a contemporary Russian piece, which is done in egg tempera. And these are, this is the same technique which has been used since the Middle Ages for icons. And once again, very high key, the modeling and the forms in here, this could almost have been done in the 12th century, at least this kind of line work to indicate the highlights in the uniform. This is George Tooker, who's a contemporary American painter, who uses egg tempera. These are small, and once again, you know, very limited range of shadow to highlight. This is Thomas Hart Benton, and I met Benton when I was 18 years old, and he's the person that got me interested in this 30-some years ago. And he used a combination of egg tempera underpainting and oil on top to make the glazes richer. This is a piece of mine showing you Egg tempera underpainting and then oil on top, just to detail the middle of the painting. But what it allows you to do is to actually get iridescences, or what are sometimes referred to in egg tempera painting as opalescences. And that's partly because what's happening optically with the underpainting with the ink, which I'll explain later more out front.
Today we're here at the Art Center of North Central College. I'm Associate Professor of Art, Barry Skurkis. It's my pleasure to introduce James Mesple as part of our Master Arts Series, which is made possible through a grant from the Naperville Sunrise Rotary Club. All right, James, take over.
Okay. We're going to be talking about egg tempera today. And the first thing I want to say is that paint in general, I assume that you all know this, that paint is basically two things. One, a pigment, and secondly, a binder, something to hold that pigment. Now, I'll talk a little bit more later on about pigments. There are various kinds. There are mineral pigments, naturally occurring earths. There's a great book called Colors from the Earth by a lady I met years ago, Ann Wall Thomas, who spent her entire life actually researching colors from the earth. This is a great little book. It's still, you can still get this. It's still available, still in print. And one of the great things about it is that it gives you the maps of where in the United States you can find the colored earths. I brought this. This is actually ochre from my brother's farm down in Arkansas. Arkansas also has some pretty bad soil and some great colors. So this is big lumps. This has been, it was dug up with a shovel and then washed in a pan, sort of like this, with water three times. You just rinse it up and then you let the ochre settle into the bottom of the pan, then you dump off the dirty water. You do it three times and you have a nice naturally occurring ochre. And this is Arkansas ochre. It's absolutely as good as the expensive ochre that you buy, which is from France. Very, very similar. But by the way, I want to say that colors from the earth vary according to the place on the planet. Now, green earths, these are three, I brought these just to show you. And this is a very small selection. I collect pigments. I have big cabinets actually full. I've been collecting them for many years. And wherever you go, you'll find that the colors, even though they have the same names, are quite different. This is a green earth from southern Italy, and they call it Verdasio, and it's a slightly darker. This is northern. This is up actually beyond Florence. This is produced by Mimeri. Naturally green earth, quite different. And then this is a third one. This is actually, I don't know where this is from. This is produced by Winsor Newton, which is a British company, and I don't know where they buy it, whether they buy it. The Swiss also have a green earth. But, you know, these are mineral colors. These are absolutely permanent, but there are three very distinct ones. Through time, as civilization progressed, and they begin to manufacture glasses, various kinds of glass and various kinds of minerals and metals which went into making the colored glasses, they also found out they could grind up the glass and the color improved. Also, contact through trade with other places brought them into contact with other kinds of rocks like malachite or lapis lazuli. And these are different kinds, actually. This is actually called celestite, which just has little particles. This can be ground up and turned into a paint. This I've used actually a couple of times. The end is ground here, which is the lighter part where it's ground away. But let me show you this. If you put this in water, what you'll see is a transformation. It's a very nice blue right now, but when it's wet, it's even deeper and darker. And this, of course, is what happens when you mix it with the binder. And that's the second part of paint. And the binder, now, what is the binder? The binder is basically what holds the ground up mineral or the ground up earth, or in some cases, like this is cobalt violet. This is actually cobalt, which has been attached to alumina. And in most colors, like manganese or any copper oxides, which are then attached to, they usually attach them to an alumina particle, or it's basically powdered aluminum. And that's what gives it its pigment quality. In other words, it gives it a structure which allows you to then attach it with a binder. And in other words, the actual chemical would be too greasy and too much of a glumpy mess to actually mix it with a binder. So you have to first break it up and attach it to the aluminum powder. And then you have something that resembles the natural earth pigments, which then will mix with any binder. Okay, binder. What is a binder? The binder is simply, as I said, something that attaches it to the surface of your panel. There are many things it could be. A very ancient one is egg, the yolk of the egg. For egg tempera to actually dry, it takes up to one full year for it to dry. Now, I should say binders. Okay, egg. Of course, there's the white, which we throw away. You could use the white also. It's called glair, G-L-A-I-R. But it never totally dries, which means it remains water-soluble like gum arabic, which is the binder used in watercolor. And of course, then there are the oils. You could use linseed oil, poppy seed oil. Various cultures and various times have used different media. Today we have acrylics, which are a polymer binder, which is a plastic binder. All of these different binders have different properties when they're mixed with the pigments. Oils tend, because you grind the pigment in the oil, oil paints tend to be much more opaque. Egg tempera painting, because you're mixing it with the egg as the binder, it's put on very, very thin, the water evaporates, and so it creates a translucent or slightly transparent. Even though you're mixing white very often with your paints, egg tempera remains transparent. Once the egg yolk dries, it's actually tougher than oil paint. This is why the stuff from the Middle Ages still is brilliantly colored. And a lot of oil paintings that were done after the Renaissance, 16th, 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries have gone very dark, because very often the oils, the linseed oils and things, yellow and get even more and more yellow and darker and darker. Egg tempera, because it's such it's not really, you're not really tiny particles in an emulsion. It's actually, what happens is, because the water evaporates, what happens is the pigments are all lined up, and it's a super thin layer that is just attached. And so they don't migrate. The layers of colors in egg tempera stay exactly where they are. So if you put if you even have black that's down, and then you have white on top of it, they stay put. So the white in 500 or 600 years will still look like a little white line over black. It won't tend to start mushing together or moving together. Because of the inflexibility, because of the good quality that it stays put, we want to use it, but it has to have a solid structure to rest on. And so one of the best things to use is masonite. You all know what masonite is, right? Mm-hmm. Now, you must ask for untempered. Tempered is treated with oil. They bake oil into it, and that's good for some exterior purposes, making the masonite last longer. Not good for our purposes, because the oil will stop the gesso and the paint from really soaking into the panel. We use masonite because this stuff is actually wood fiber, but it's been pressed with a very high heat and steam, so they're all locked together, and it's homogeneous. By homogeneous, you know, we mean it's the same all throughout. There are no big knots in it, it's not going to crack on you. It should be cradled on the back. The best thing, and I didn't bring a cradled one, but it should be, by cradle I simply mean you should attach with glue at least a frame going around the outside. It gets quite a bit heavier. Some people actually build a frame into them. But you can go up to about 20 to 23 inches without cradling it if you're willing to get the quarter inch masonite.
That doesn't warp, James?
Yeah. Well, this one is slightly warped, and the other one is not. And the reason it's not is because once you get the front done, you need to also gesso the back. And so what is pulled, as you can see, this one's slightly curved. As this one is pulled from the front, by the time you put it on the back, then it will pull it back so that the tension is the same on both sides. That's what you're after. You even want to do the edges. The edges even should be gessoed. You don't have to make an eggshell finish. I mean, it's totally, some people actually like, you know, having a sort of a texture to their surface. It depends on what you want. So the old method, of course, was to put on 3 to 5 coats of gesso, sanding it and sanding it and sanding it till it was absolutely, as smooth as an eggshell. but you don't have to do that. A very fast way to apply this, in fact, is just to get yourself commercial gesso and then to use a car applicator and just squeegee it on like that, just drag it across, you know, do it. By the time you get one method done, one direction done, let it set for just a couple of minutes, then you can come back and do the other direction, and you can build up five coats very quickly. The same thing when you use it on the back, it just will scrape it into the crevices. These are very inexpensive. You can get a whole package of them for, you know, a dollar or something. When you start drawing, the point of egg tempera is that it's a two-part process. You're going to do your drawing, get your drawing done with basically India ink, and you dilute the India ink into three different dilutions. I've done A, B, and C here, a very dilute, a middle, and then, of course, quite dark. It's still not pure ink. It's still about, 50% water. The thing is, you really want a separate brush for each one of the mixtures.
James, do you use distilled water in this?
I use distilled water in this also. I use distilled water in everything because chlorine, and also there's just little bits of stuff coming out of pipes and stuff. So, see, even the 50% solution, which is 50% water and ink, will come out very, very dark. You don't want to use pure India ink, even if you're using it with a crow quill pen or with a very small brush. It's just there's a little too much, there's actually shellac in here, it's a little too oily. So you want to dilute it. I'm going to just very quickly hit the background with the darker solution and just lay this in, and we're letting it dry while we're doing the rest of it. Actually, I want something a little darker than that. This is a fourth solution, which has just a little bit less water. The problem with the egg tempera, by the way, is as far as the brushes and all that sort of thing goes, is even though you wash them with soap and water, you never totally get the egg yolk out of them. You have to be sort of meticulous about cleaning your brushes, but if you get a crust of egg on the things, it's very hard to remove. When they're allowed to remain, the tempera usually tends to spoil quickly. It is egg. It will spoil. Okay. Tempera was once called la pittura al putrido. Does that sound familiar? Putrid. Okay. But this nickname need not be deserved. A little care and forethought will remove any trace of unpleasant odor about the studio. Well, it's actually, if you're painting a lot, invariably there's something laying around, and it does end up smelling like rotten eggs. Now, you're seeing how this dries, you see, and it's drying actually much lighter than, that's what I wanted you to see. It's quite different. I mean, even in acrylic, there's a shift in acrylic, but with dilute inks, there's a very big shift in what it looks like wet and what it looks like dry. And what you'll want to do is, if you want it to go really dark, you can give it a second layer. In this case, I don't. This gray will be just fine. Because the paint is going to go on top of that. The thing that you find also when you're working with a water-based media like the egg tempera is that even though you're using a fairly small brush, you can actually cover quite a bit of area fairly quickly once you get used to using it. And the other thing is, you don't have to be all that careful in your layout like this, because you can alter things. You can't alter things, I can't shift the face over like this because it would bleed through. You would always see it. But you can alter the edges of things, so you don't have to be absolutely perfectly accurate on your layout. You can shift things back and forth with the egg tempera itself, along the edges of lines, I should say. And you notice I'm using, when you want to pull a line, you don't pull a line by taking the point and going along the line. You actually push the brush down and just pull your line along with the edge of the brush. You get a much more accurate edge that way. If you were working on a serious work of art, you're going to spend, a week or so on, you could actually do the entire drawing. You could work it out in over time, very slowly with, you know, beautiful crosshatching, you could develop the form and have complete control of it. Ordinarily, I probably would actually lay this down flat for doing this kind of line work, simply because the line, if you wanted it thicker and blacker, you could make it thicker, but it would just lay on the surface and not start running down. You can actually, even with the ink, you can do a little bit of modeling at this point just by having some paper towel ready and wiping something out like that, you know, on the cheek if you want to. I mean, this, you're going to, it's going to be painted over anyway, but you can actually begin to develop your form at this point in the ink underpainting. And that's really part of the whole process is to start developing your shadows. Okay. So we're really ready to start right now. I mean, we could develop this much, much more with the tones of the gray. It could be developed to a highly refined grisaille. We don't have time in here, but this will give you the idea of what's going to happen. Okay. Now, all of these paints, all of these powdered pigments are translucent. So you'll want to add a little bit of water. I mean, a little bit of white with them. This is the egg yolk right here. Now, did you read on the handout I gave you? You can dilute the egg yolk. The amount you dilute it with is up to you. You might even want to use it directly out of the egg, quite thick and very sort of viscous. But you can dilute it up to 1/2. I wouldn't go beyond 1/2, because if you do that, you won't have enough egg oil to bind the paint to the surface. I didn't show you though how I got this yolk. Let me just very quickly show you this. The way you want to do this is you want to have paper towel ready and you want to have something to throw the white into. We're not going to use the white. Okay, so you simply crack the egg, pull it apart, and let the yolk stay in. Okay, and just dump it back and forth a couple of times to get rid of the white. Trying not to break the yolk. Actually, I use a lot of these fertilized vegetarian eggs simply because the yolks are thicker and the shells are thicker and they're a little bit stronger. Now what you do is just very gently dump it onto a paper towel. Okay? Save this or discard for right now, and just give it a little roll, let it roll around a little bit, and what you're doing is drying it out just a little bit. When you get it out toward the edge of the paper towel, then get your paintbrush ready and give it a poke. Okay, and now you do not want the sac of the egg to go in there. It will contaminate the whole thing. You want to squeeze it out. You want only the good stuff inside, so you're holding the sac in the paper towel. Okay, it'll putrefy. You don't want the sac. And now you can mix half as much water with that, and we've got our distilled water here someplace. I dumped some out. Here we go. So I'm just going to use, we know that it came from the shell, we know that it's not much bigger. I'm going to just dump actually about half this shell with water until it's about half full, and we can add that. And that way we're safe to know that we're not diluting it too much. And now we put the lid on it. I use bigger jars like this because then you can just do this, you know, sort of like, you know, a couple of cooks I watched did something like this. So it just quickly mixes it. You don't want to shake it up and down, you know, just give it a good mixing like this. Now, we've got we've put some of this egg yolk in with the blue paint. Now I'm just going to give it a quick stir just to get this mixed up. Okay, now what happens when we go over the ink? The ink is quite dry at this point. Okay, so it's not going to go anyplace. But if you noticed on your handout, it talks about the function of the monochrome drawing. The whole composition is worked out in monochrome on the gesso surface of the panel. The modeling indicated ordinarily by lines or washes of ink on the pure white of the gesso. By painting over this shading with tones always somewhat lighter than the parts of the shading that they cover, the halftones and shadows and reflected lights in the drawing are automatically converted into opalescent tones of pink. Now, if I put this blue directly on the black right now, we won't really get that opalescent effect because the blue is actually darker than. So we want to lighten this up. And how do we do that? With a little bit of white. So we take just a touch of white into here. And with tempera, you find that you mix the white with just about all your colors. It doesn't take much. The tiniest amount will make it slightly opaque or translucent. Never totally opaque. But once we do that, you'll see when this dries, the difference is quite amazing. And that took very, very little. Let's give this a quick over. I'll leave that one little spot with the original blue. It's just too translucent. The blue's too translucent, and also it's too dark. It needs to go up into that higher tonality, that higher range, in order to get the opalescent effects. Now, what's interesting about egg tempera is that even though this was quite roughly done underneath, and even though I'm putting on a super thin coat, you'll see some striations, but you'll be amazed at how flat, once it dries, how flat it is for two very super thin coats of paint. Ordinarily with acrylic or with oil, you would have to either put the paint on thicker or apply several different layers in order to get as much coverage for your money, so to speak. Now the other part is you can almost start going in the opposite direction almost immediately. This stuff almost dries to the touch. It's dry within just seconds. And that's what allows you, when you look at some of those incredibly intricate Renaissance paintings, you're thinking, how in a human lifetime could they have gotten those things done? And the real answer lies in the speed of the medium. It dries almost instantly to the touch, so there's just no waiting around. You can just start going right back again. And it's amazing, even though you're using much smaller brushes, it's amazing how once you've done a few of these, you can get very fast at laying this on with a small brush. And you can cover a lot of area. A good egg tempera painter can cover, you know, a couple of feet of area very, very quickly with a small brush. And unlike watercolor, which is completely unforgiving, I mean, watercolor, everything shows through. The beauty of the egg tempera process is that you can cover your mistakes. You can actually, as I said, you can't literally shift the face over, but you can cover the edges of forms as things change very quickly. If you're losing your pointed brush, just give your brush a roll right on the surface and you'll get it back to a point, then you can go in and get those smaller sections. Now by the time I've got that done, I could probably go back and put in, let's see if this shows up as a, see, it's laying right on top of the others. Even though that's not even totally dry yet, it's suspending itself. You can see each brush stroke. You know what really works wonderfully for this process also are all the oriental brushes, the bamboo brushes, the Chinese brushes, because it's the same principle. It's a great big moppy brush that holds lots of liquid, and you can use it very flat on its side like that to cover a big space, but you can give it a twist and be back to a point in just a couple of seconds. So all of the bamboo, the sumi brushes that are used for sumi painting can be used for egg tempera beautifully.
Well, would those clean very well?
Yeah, I mean, you just need to wash them. The best thing I found for cleaning your brushes with egg tempera, you know, once again, you'll putrido. You do want to get the egg yolk out. The best thing is just cheap shampoo, like Suave or something like that, that you can get for $1.29 a bottle, for a great big bottle. It's the best thing. Hand soaps are too rough, and especially on good Chinese brushes. Those have really delicate hairs.
How long do your paintings
paints that you've mixed up keep, James? Do you pretty much use one color at a time?
Yeah, you try to mix up only what you use in one day. They'll last for a couple of days, and you can put them in the ice box, and you can keep them in jars and things, but...
You mean with the egg in already?
With the egg in it, yeah, it'll last for about 3 days. Some people use, I should tell you this, if you want to try it, you can. Some people use just a drop of clove oil, which stops it from deteriorating, and it'll last for about a week and a half. By the way, you can still see these three stripes that I painted there, which was just, you know, right on top of there. This one, look, you can get that covered up now also. But let's watch what happens now with just... we'll let this dry a little bit. When you're developing forms in tempera, one of the things that you'll discover right away is that after three or four layers, it just keeps changing and changing. Because it is translucent, everything you put down will eventually affect the outcome. Whereas in oil, very often, you know, you get so many layers and then you begin to lose things, or you can actually cover things up. But you'll find in tempera that it just keeps coming through. So you can use that, of course, you can use that process to actually help you. So you won't necessarily want to always paint with the color that ultimately you want it to be. In other words, if you're going to do flesh, you might want to do your shadows actually in a complementary color, even though you want the flesh to actually have shadows that are in the pinky orangey ranges. You might want to actually go in with a completely complementary color, like a green or something, for the shadows. And the other thing is that before you lose all of your white, well, you'll never totally lose it because it'll always be coming back through. But while you can still take advantage of some of it, you might want to try something like this. On something like the hair, scratch through this, of course, creating lighter lines depending on where you've left the light. I almost obliterated the light through here, but down here where I've still got it, you can still see it. And you can create these. Now, of course, you don't have to leave these as white scratches. These then can be gone over and filled in with another color, and you know, as you're gradually building up the form. You can also simply separate the hairs of the brush and actually drag and create textures with the brush itself. You can also use paper towel or other forms to actually scratch through to create forms. Not as controlled as something like this, but on a piece this big, actually at this distance, these sort of little things are kind of lost, actually. If on a much smaller, if you were working on a little panel 8 by 10 inches, this could come in very handy for creating, you know, some detail and textures and things. Now you can scratch through this actually for quite a while. The thing is that this, now this, of course, I'll be scratching through to, I won't see much because I'm scratching through to that gray that's underneath. That will be very, almost impervious to scratching because it's actually soaked into the gesso. But what I'm trying to say is that since this takes quite a long time to actually completely set up, you can even make scratches the next day. Now, what we're going to do is cover the entire face with a tone. We'll go to take some yellow ochre and then some white.
Oh, those paints go a long way, don't they?
Yeah, they really do. You don't need that much. And you can also keep diluting them with water. That's going to be too thick right now, so we'll dilute it with a little more egg yolk. And just make a thin wash. I really should have let this set up for about another 5 minutes to really get a better foundation. It's breaking loose a little bit, but that's okay.
And then what does it do? It's blending in with the greens? Or?
Yeah, uh-huh. And actually I didn't want that. You really want it coming underneath but not actually mm-hmm. blending with it. That's okay. I'll touch it up later. But if I just left it just another 5 minutes, but 5 minutes is a long time in a demonstration like this, so we'll just go with it. You know, this color could actually be used, it'll actually blend in quite nicely just with some of the scrape that I did earlier. You can overemphasize lines if you want to, because you can then put a lighter wash on top of it and, you know, and tone it back down, and you can get some nice effects like that. If you actually, for instance, this is too dark for what I'm doing, but it'll work simply because I'm going to go back and cover it later. This is going to look very harsh for right now. Scratching in can be very useful on things like feathers and things, or scratching in areas that you want to develop later. These are skewers, you know, like you buy at the store, just to skewer things with. And when they're nice, actually, you can actually end up breaking them if you want to, and you can get some interesting effects just by, they tend to feather when you do that. You can actually just, you know, get some really nice effects just using the broken ends. White becomes very important now as we start to develop the picture. I don't want to contaminate all the white, so I'm just going to take out just enough for me to use right now. Now I'm going to dilute the white with a little more egg yolk. Till I get a transparent white. And I'll soon be able to tell whether it's enough. I may have to add some more to it, we'll see. Okay, this would actually work for developing the form. You want it to be transparent enough that your underpainting starts showing through, and then you can start developing your lights. Now, for the purposes of the demonstration, I'm going to mix a little more white in this and make it a little more dramatic. Although, theoretically, you can use something this translucent and this thin and just keep adding strokes over it, and it will get whiter and whiter and whiter. And of course, therein lies the principle of the egg tempera, which is just developing the form slowly by starting. If you start too bright, you'll just get white strokes on top of it. If you start with that, you'll just get a brilliant white stroke.
Yeah.
But if you start by diluting it, you're slowly building up the form, and you can what's called feathering it. You can feather mm-hmm. one form into another. She's going to have a little white mark on her nose now if I don't get rid of that right away. But so the idea is, in cross-hatching, where you use black ink and you're developing lines, and the more lines you make, the denser and darker the form becomes. This is exactly the reverse. By using white, translucent white, by interlocking the forms, the denser and lighter it becomes. Mm-hmm. And of course, this is really what we're doing with egg temperas, is developing a basket network of form, which becomes lighter and lighter. Okay, now this would be to develop this. And of course, the other thing is that you want to remember, it works best if you let your lines, your egg tempera lines, follow the direction of the form. For instance, if this is going here, if I just draw across like this, just straight across and straight across like that, I will get a light patch here on her cheek. But it's far better if I follow the cheek. If you feel you're getting, if it's getting too much, you can smooth it. You can blend it with your hands. There's, you know, it's not the traditional method, it's true. But you can do it. And actually, if you look closely, especially the Renaissance pieces, the oils, there actually are fingerprints in them. You can see that they're actually manipulating the paint. They also used to use a whole variety of little leather tools, which were basically just the little pieces of leather on the ends of sticks, and they would use those to manipulate the paint also. This is titanium white, not lead white, so I can use my fingers. Now, something like this, like on the beak and on the feet, what I'll probably do is come in here with white, actually, to develop the form somewhat. But the white is simply an underlayment. It'll look quite crude. And then I'll come back with a yellow ochre over both the red and the white, which will unite the two together. So a three-step process. The darker color first, then the lighter color, then the middle tone color. Now, the actual process that I put down on your on the paper, and I think it's the best process to use in general, which I've tried to do here, which was to hit it with a in the both the monochrome and in the color, to hit it with a middle tone first, and then come back with, you can do either one, either the shadows and the highlights or the highlights and the shadows, but starting with the middle tone, which gives you a point to work from and a point to push against and to raise up. These could be, once again, these forms right here, which are just very crude lights, but they'll be toned down with yellow. And that can be done almost immediately. For instance, I just mixed up, I have a yellow ochre, which is, an ochre is fairly opaque. I've mixed a cadmium yellow with it, just a touch, another opaque color. Okay, how opaque is it? We don't know till we test it. So it's good to keep a board like this around and just see, you know, well, it's fine. The gray tones come through. But if I'd mixed it up too pasty or too thick, it could have been too opaque. I mean, it'll never be, as I said, never totally opaque. But I'm going to try to cover, this is even allowing this very pale gray line to show through so that we know it's fine. I want to cover up the hair, and so I want these white lines that I've just painted in to be sure they come right through. Now, this is actually a good example because we've got the red underneath and even the dark. And
that's interesting.
And so the middle tone actually unites, is uniting all three. Those white lines that I just put on just a few seconds ago, they stayed put, basically, because they set up very, very quickly. Now this yellow, used very thinly, can be used to warm up all of this. Because there's no red in there, the effect that I'll get from the same glaze will be very different. With that, remember it has some green underpainting and then that beige tone, which was basically a white with a little bit of raw umber. Sometimes you get surprises. Actually, this green actually got emphasized with the yellow actually brings it out even stronger. At this point, I'm going to use some of it down here because we want to remember if you have a reflected light really is never as bright as your actual highlights, and so we want to take that down. And we're putting it over. Remember, this was a black we put directly on it very crudely at first, but it has set up at this point, so it's not mixing with it. I think we'll bring this right on up there. That needs to set up for a minute because before I have to put it over there over that. I'm going to do it on the mouth. I've lost the line on the mouth. I want to regain that. And the best way to do that is actually to pick it out with white and then to go back and tone it down like I did on the hair. Now we'll have to let that set up for a second before we come back. With some color on top of that. Things like this, like the arm, you have a cylinder form here. Once again, these could be made, rather than just putting on the highlight, you can actually draw them in the directions of the structure of the form. Same thing with the fingers and things. You have lights that you want to put in. Curve your lines. Now I want to bring some of this blue actually into the eyes, into the whites of the eyes. And this looks really terrible, just drawing blue lines like this. But the idea is you're going to draw them now, let them dry, and then cover them up with white. And then they'll just basically be glowing sort of through the white. It's actually better than doing the white than just trying to dilute the blue and just painting it right on top. But I have to let it dry for a second. As you work toward finishing any area, of course, any of the lights that you're placing on need to get subtler and subtler rather than, you know, just pure white, using tones that will tie in with the form more easily at this point. Let's see. I'd like to go over the background of the color. I'm going to mix another blue, which is going right on top of the other blue that's there. Now this won't look like anything while it's wet, but as soon as it dries, you'll see a difference in it. Now rather than going around this bird, I'm just going to go right on top of it. Because the colors are so closely related, it won't really hurt it that much, and actually it may give me an interesting color. So dark that I'm really losing it. So when I go back with the white and take it back out, when this something like this happens, it's not a loss really. And the nice thing is you don't have to wait for it to dry. It's dry. So you just go right back into it. Now I would like to be able to show you the finish, which unfortunately I can't, because I can guarantee you that if I I'm going to put a wash over this in a second, but if I tried to actually give it an egg yolk wash over the whole thing at this point, it would start moving it around. It really needs to set at least overnight before you, but if I did that, you get a very nice waxy, satiny look to it. Egg temperas have what's called a sheen, which is not shiny like a varnish, but it's not matte like gouache either. Gouache is, you know, very chalky and very dry. It's in between. Of course, it's satin.
James, if people are interested in picking up pigments, where would you recommend for them to purchase that?
Okay, this just came from Pearl. Excuse me. Gamelin is the cheapest one you can get. They're manufacturing these now, and they're supplying them to universities and colleges all over the country. I talked to the guy at Pearl who explained to me, and they're. What they've done is they're producing a good powdered pigment. They actually have things like cobalt violet and stuff like that, which are very expensive, which are locked away. But out on the regular cabinet are things like this, and the Pearl price, I mean, this is, you know, synthetic blue is one of the cheaper ones, $5.16. This is a lot. This will last you. As you can see, I mean, I put, you know, a quarter of a teaspoon, of a plastic teaspoon, which isn't even a normal teaspoon, into these things, and I haven't, other than getting a new color, which I forgot about, I haven't gotten any others. But I could, and I've got enough in these, I can continue painting. I could continue painting for another 3 hours on this.
And you know, you just could save these too, right? And can you save these and
No, don't mix up more than you'll use in a day, because they're, you can save it overnight in the ice box, but...
But not necessarily. Just little amounts.
Just little amounts. In fact, if you read El Libro del Arte, Chinino Chini's book, the size, he tells you the size that you should mix up. the size of a lintel.
Oh, really?
Do you know what a lintel is?
Little beans in my hand.
Mix up a lintel at a time and use it until you're... And of course, his thing is, because you're diluting it with a lot of egg yolk, he says you'll be shocked at how long a lintel will last. Because you're just veiling it, you know, just very, very, very thin. Not like, I mean, I'm showing you the process, but you understand if you're going to build up slowly, you have to literally build up slowly, you know, with very dilute, a lot of egg yolk, a little bit of pigment, and just in a gossamer area, just keep applying and applying. It's like building a tapestry. And that's the metaphor he uses, like threads. You're just laying threads. It's embroidery. It's embroidery with forbidden eye stitch. Okay, if you want to talk about, but you don't have to use it that way. You can use it much more aggressively and much more assertively. But if you want to actually create the effects that they got, you have to use the forbidden stitch, which is a very tiny brush and an almost dry brush, and using no pressure at all, just raking it over the surface and very gradually applying these strokes. If you're going to do it, start on, you know, a little small piece first, because it is time-consuming to actually build up form in that way.
Nothing else really works, though, this way.
No, that's right. Nothing looks like it, and nothing really works that way. But, you know, it is the reason, I'm sure, why most of the, most of the pieces were small. Mm-hmm. Even Thompson, who probably was the world's leading authority in the 20th century on, that last century, on egg tempera painting. He talks about size, and he says the average size for an egg tempera painting is between 20 square inches and 20 square feet. Now what that means is, he says you really can't get much bigger than that. 20 square inches would be 4 by 5 inches. Now see, all of these lines that are, you know, that I went back and was drawing back in, those are just very, you know, just very crudely laid out. Those would all need to be softened now again. And what I would use is go back with a lighter tone, with a white. And possibly a touch of the red. And then, so this could all be softened.
But it still glows through.
See, you're working so thinly that you can keep building up and building up and building up and building up. You know, just, I mean, literally, if you wanted to, hundreds of layers. Because it's so thin. So it's not going to really... become a problem to control. It's not going to become great big lumpy valleys and mountains of paint, because it's basically like water. So you can keep developing the form as you see it, and keep redefining your form and your line. And you may find that you want something that wasn't even in the initial concept. Just for instance, I mean, I don't know if this is necessarily a good idea for this or not compositionally, but let's forget about the composition right now. If you wanted something that was out in here, let's say a plant or something coming, you can just draw right on top of what's already there. And I was showing you this. This was very evident in those Pompeian pieces, where you can actually just add right on top.
You know, there's nothing like a demonstration. You know, you can read a process, but to actually see a process and the artist, they like our one.
Okay. James, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
It's been a pleasure. I'm sure the audience appreciated it. And thanks again to the Sunrise Rotary Club of Naperville for making this possible. Thanks so much.
Very, very nice.
You're very welcome.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
This is mostly carbon, of course. Now, the thing that happens with egg tempera, which I'll explain later, but I just want to say it now so that you sort of have it in your head. The thing that happens with egg tempera is it doesn't really, the beauty of oil paint, of course, is that you develop forms with the oil. Egg tempera is a much more linear process. It lends itself more to line. My own personal feeling is that line is very, very important. I think that in some ways it's underestimated in contemporary times. And I guess I would liken it, I would say that there are sort of voices which we're able to impart into our artwork, whether it's a line of melody and music or a line in visual art. And although in these very early cave paintings, although there are forms that are developed, such as this one, where they're developing the form, they very often will start with the line itself. And this one's very fascinating, of course, because it's a grid. We have no idea what this means, whether it's magic or trying to lay out something with constellations or whatever, or time. We're not really sure. But what's fascinating to me, of course, is that we have sienna, and then we have carbon, we have burnt sienna. So we have as many different clays as they could lay their hands on. Jumping forward thousands and thousands of years, 20,000 years, getting into our earliest civilizations, we have people like the Sumerians and the Ur standard. This is all lapis lazuli, of course, cut around here. But in cutting and fitting this together, it didn't take long to find out that as you were cutting on a stone with a harder stone, that you were going to get powder. And of course, the powder was going to color your hands. And hey, guess what? If it colors my hands, I can use it to color an object. So very quickly, they started using it. And of course, the Egyptians, all the tombs are filled with color. And the Egyptians were one of the earliest groups to come up with the idea of using frits in glasses and then grinding up the glass, colored glasses, aquamarine or blue colored glasses or green colored glass. They really began painting just about everything, even their furniture. There's actually a segment up here. Some is inlaid, of course, but some is actually just paint. And jumping, once again, jumping forward another thousand years, we come to the Romans. And because many of the houses actually were done with an interior courtyard, that meant the bedrooms and the rooms off the side of the house had no windows. They looked inside the courtyard, but they had no windows to the outside world. So very often they began painting landscapes on the wall so that as they would lay in bed, they would have a vista looking out. Some of these are quite amazing. Once again, you're dealing with the same earth colors. They haven't added much. They really don't have much trade going on with the Middle East, with Afghanistan, which had the primary sources for lapis lazuli. So they don't have a great blue in general. But it's amazing that over all these thousands of years, from prehistoric to Roman, we're still dealing pretty much with the same earth colors. Some of these Roman paintings are quite amazing. They're actually beginning to get into modeling of forms.
What time frame do you think that's?
This is Pompeian. This is Pompeian, yeah. And so you're right at, 100 BC. Mm-hmm. Some are absolutely thrilling. They're just, you can actually see the line work and you can see them actually drawing the forms and then putting on the dots at the ends of each branch to give it more three-dimensionality. Mm-hmm. But once again, a very limited palette. They're doing the most they can. They don't really have a great green, so they're using black, but because of optical contrast, you're tending to see the black, you're reading it as green, as a dark green. Part of that is because since it's neutral and you're having the red earths next to it, you're going to start seeing the complement. So since green is the complement of red, you're going to think of those as green trees, even though it's just basically a black pigment. Some are quite erotic, of course. And once again, I put this in because they're already developing, these are Roman, they're already developing form through here. And it's using small hatch lines, which is exactly the way they'll be doing 1,000 years later in the medieval period with the Egg Tempera. And this is where we are. This is jumping forward 1,000 years. And these are Egg Temperas, and they're using it both in very flat areas, linear, and then attempting to develop form already by using the white as a cross-hatching method. Once again, drawn, it's really, the forms are really drawn and delineated through drawing. A couple of hundred years later, and we're seeing forms develop, but we're still seeing, the beauty of it is that you can draw very small details with them. Now, of course, what happens is in early Renaissance, things, they really exploit the medium to, as far as they can. They push it and push it and push it, trying to develop forms and three-dimensionality through modeling. And what the way they do this, which I'll demonstrate to you, is by slowing the process down to the point where they're using an almost dry brush and just the tiniest bit of pigment and very slowly raking and raking and raking, trying to build form. And of course, oil paint comes in shortly after this, which pretty much kills it because oil paint really allows you to model. It stays wet long enough that you can add forms and develop forms. But of course, what you gain in modeling, you do lose something in the iridescent, opalescent quality of the egg tempera. This, of course, is natural lapis blue, which is probably being imported by donkeys all the way from Afghanistan at that point into Italy, and then ground up, being imported as rocks. It gets pushed to a very, very high level. Although, if you'll notice, it's still not a great many colors. It's still somewhat limited. And of course, Botticelli. Most people don't realize the Primavera by Botticelli. This is an egg tempera painting. It's a huge one, but it's egg tempera. And these forms are developed. When you see the actual painting at the Uffizi in Florence, they're developed. It's almost gossamer. I mean, he's mixing so much egg medium with the pigment, very, very little pigment and medium, and then just slowly developing, breaking it over the surface. Of course, everything in the background had to be painted first before it's applied on top. What happens at the Renaissance is it's moving in two directions at once. There are some artists that are still using the egg tempera in a more flat medieval approach. There are others who are pushing it to its absolute limits, like Botticelli, attempting to develop form and three-dimensionality with the egg tempera. So it's sort of going off in two directions at once. And then there are artists, once oil paint comes in, this is oil paint, this is Hieronymus Bosch, but I put it in because there are some oil painters who continue to use oil paint with the egg tempera technique, with a much more drawing, linear technique, very crisp edges, not terribly modeled. I mean, areas like this are, still quite flat, actually. The modeling is very, very subtle. Even though it's oil, he's using it in more in a tempera approach. And even when you see the actual paintings, These are in the Prado in Madrid. If you see the actual paintings, they'll be actually little hatch marks where he's applying the oil, and in some cases doesn't even smooth it or model it, he just leaves it direct. And of course, at High Renaissance, you have, as I said, a complete development, really pushing it as far as it would go, which of course is why oil comes in. They really pushed egg tempera to its outer limits in developing the form. We have a wonderful Botticelli at the Art Institute downtown, which you can't really see the brush strokes till you're literally right up on it. You almost have to make the buzzer go off in order to really see it. And if you get up that close, you can see literally thousands of tiny, tiny brush marks built up in a very slow process. That's not the only way to use egg tempera, by the way. There are ways to use it much more loosely, like Andrew Wyeth or like Paul Cadmus, but that was the approach at that time. Now, the thing, have you noticed something else, by the way, that's different than oil paint as you're looking at these slides? There's something else I'm hoping you'll notice, and that is that they tend to be very high keyed in color. In other words, they don't have the depth of an oil painting. And that's one of the things that they don't have. But it's one of the things you sacrifice in egg tempera because it's a higher key. It would be really like a violin, whereas you might think of oil as a cello. It has a possibility of much deeper, more resonant tones. And that's because with the oil, because the layers, the binder of the oil, actually makes various strata that are much thicker and farther apart. You can go into blacks with oil, which are like as black as like black velvet or something, very, very deep. You can't really, what happens in egg tempera is it starts getting chalky looking if you try to do that. The blacks don't really come off really deep. You have to do it actually with ink, an underpainting first and then blacks on top. But they look fine by themselves, but if you put it next to an oil painting, it won't have the depth. So they tend to stay in a much higher key, much higher level. We're fortunate we have this one, which is unfinished, and we can see actually the grisaille, the underpainting, which is on before they begin adding the color on top of it. This is an unfinished piece. This one is highly finished, you know, brought to a very high level of completion. And this one also. Okay, this is a contemporary, let's see the plates. So this is a contemporary Russian piece, which is done in egg tempera. And these are, this is the same technique which has been used since the Middle Ages for icons. And once again, very high key, the modeling and the forms in here, this could almost have been done in the 12th century, at least this kind of line work to indicate the highlights in the uniform. We have a dirigible up there and some airplanes. Recognize this?
Yes.
This is George Tooker, who's a contemporary American painter who uses egg tempera. These are small, and once again, you know, very limited range of shadow to highlight. Using it, really exploiting the drawing aspects, you know, for the linear aspects of the line work. Now Leonardo, even though he was using oil, would use what's called a combination or a mixed technique, mixing egg yolk in with his oil paints to do very, very tiny things like this on the hair, just to lay them on the surface. They have a slightly raised quality to it. What happens is the egg yolk makes the oil set up very quickly, like that. So you can draw, you have to have an underpainting of oil first, and while it's wet, you paint with the egg oil emulsion, it's called, an egg oil emulsion, which you shake up. You paint that right into the wet oil paint, and you can make very crisp details, which just stay there. If they were mixed with oil itself, by the time you diluted it with turpentine to hold its ridge, it would hold when you drew it, but within a minute or two, it would start spreading out. So this is a mixed technique which was exploited by the late Renaissance artists like Leonardo. Today, this is Thomas Hart Benton, and I met Benton when I was 18 years old, and he's the person that got me interested in this 30-some years ago. And he used a combination of egg tempera underpainting and oil on top to make the glazes richer. This one, but even though this has oil on top of the egg tempera, the tonality that he's using with the lights and everything are very similar to a pure egg tempera painting. And if you can see this up close, once again, the way he's applying his lights and things, once again, it's very much a tempera sort of technique. Just throw this in to, once again, reiterate, you know, the limited range of shadow and light. For things like this, where it's more linear and you're interested more in the drawing and in the linear form, it's a perfect technique. I'm sorry, that's flipped. This is our great piece, which is at the Art Institute, which I hope if you don't know it, you please go see it. It's got wonderful raised teeth and eyes and things where he's applied gesso for the St. George and the Dragon. Just reiterating, it's a limited palette with earth colors to start with. As time progresses and they get more and more exotic minerals coming in, and then of course they get glasses, which they're grinding up with chromium and with copper oxides, the palette expands. This is a piece of mine showing you egg tempera underpainting and then oil on top, just a detail for the middle of the painting. But what it allows you to do is to actually get iridescences, or what are sometimes referred to in egg tempera painting as opalescences. And that's partly because what's happening optically with the underpainting with the ink, which I'll explain later more out front. This is an Adam and Eve. This is just direct oil, just direct egg tempera. No oil, just pure egg tempera. In some cases, I was even actually, these are older pieces I was applying forms to them, which I was cutting off and applying to the surfaces. Okay. That's all. Well, I'll show you the other work later, which is just my own work, which ties in. But I want to go back.